Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Classics, A Very Short Introduction, by Mary Beard and John Henderson, narrated by Julia Whelan.
Chapter 1. The Visit. In and out of the museum. This introduction to classics begins with a brief visit to a museum. We have chosen the British Museum in London, and one particular room, housing one particular monument that survives from ancient Greece. A museum is a good place to look for ancient Greece and Rome, but this visit will be the starting point for an exploration of classics that extends far beyond any museum and its objects. Our visit follows the route set out for us by the numbering on the plan provided for visitors to the museum, which the various guidebooks also follow, in sequence through the galleries. Up the grand flight of steps, through the tall columns of the classical porch, into the front hall, and past the bookshop. On through the burial urns and giant Ali Baba jars that stand for heroic prehistoric Greece, rooms 1 and 2, and the first stiff marble figures that mark the beginning of classical sculpture, rooms 3 and 4. Then we weave our way around the cases of shiny red and black Greek vases, room 5, until we reach the bottom of a narrow staircase that promises to take us off the main track. We haven't reached the prize exhibit of the Parthenon sculptures yet. A deviation, then, and a surprise in store. We climb the stairs to room 6, which is on a mezzanine floor above the other galleries. Past an emotive picture of ancient ruins, drawn by some milord who has emphatically included the signs of his class and character, his gun and dog. Our destination turns out to be a specially designed exhibition room, with carefully planned spotlights trained to set off a series of carved stone slabs about 0.5 meter high, laid end to end to form a frieze, a strip of fighting bodies, men, women, horses, half-horses, that runs around the room at eye level. Not a centimeter to spare. This room was built to fit. A couple of information panels are here to help. These sculptures, they tell us, once formed the frieze, carved towards the end of the 5th century BCE, inside the temple of the god Apollo at a place called Bassae in Arcadia, a remote district in the southwestern corner of Greece. The frieze, so the panels explain, show two of the most famous scenes of Greek myth. Half of this mass of bodies turn out to be combatants in the Battle of Greeks with the half-man, half-horse centaurs, who, in true beastly fashion, had spoiled a wedding feast by trying to steal the women. The other half are fighters in the conflict between Greeks, Greek men, that is, and Heracles himself in the lead, and the wild warrior women Amazons, strange and uncivilized. It was, the information tells us, one of the famous 12 labors of Heracles, in Latin, Hercules, to steal the belt of the Amazon queen. And the frieze is all here in the British Museum precisely because of the English milord and his friends, whose picture we noticed on the way up. In the early 19th century, the remains of the temple at Bassae were rediscovered by a group of English, German, and Danish archaeologist explorers. In a matter of months, they were able to make a small fortune when the sculpture was auctioned off to the British government. A few fragments have ended up in Copenhagen, a few are still in Greece, but essentially the whole thing was brought back to England. There's a puzzle here, though, as the information panel explains. This museum room may have been built to fit, but to fit what? The 23 individual slabs, here neatly laid out end to end, side by side, were found widely scattered around the ruins of the temple, one by one, in complete confusion. And no one has ever been quite sure what goes with what, how to do this great stone jigsaw, or what exactly the picture is supposed to be. If you examine the drawings of the slabs of the frieze outline, you will be following one solution to the problem of the original layout. What we see in the museum's Bassae room can be no more and no less than someone's best guess at how it might once have looked. At how it might once have looked? Never mind the jigsaw puzzle. The information panels have already alerted us to the fact that these sculptures, in their ancient setting, never looked much like this. In their temple, they were high up, 7 meters up the wall of the inner room of the sanctuary, poorly lit, probably difficult to see, let's imagine plenty of dust and cobwebs. They were not conveniently at eye level, spotlit for our attention. It's stating the obvious, of course, to say that we are in a museum whose job it is to present these works of art for our inspection, admiration, or study, clean, tidy, and explained. Stating the obvious to say that the temple at Bassae was no museum, but a religious shrine, and that these sculptures were part of a holy place, whose own visitors, as we shall see, had not come looking for labels and explanations of what they saw. After all, they knew the stories of Heracles against the Amazons, Greeks against the Centaurs, from Granny's knee. There is a big gap, in other words, between the historical context and the modern display. Museums always operate with that gap, and we museum visitors have learned to take it for granted. We are not surprised, for example, to find a prehistoric spearhead, once, maybe, lodged fatally and bloodily in the skull of some unfortunate fighter, laid out in front of us in an elegant showcase. We do not even imagine that any of those gleaming museum reconstructions of the Roman kitchen, with their wholesome ingredients and cheerful waxwork slave cooks, capture much of the grimmer realities of Roman, or any, cooking and domestic labor. That is how museums are. We are not deceived by their displays to think they simply represent the past. At the same time, the gap between the museum and the past, between us and them, prompts a series of questions. In the case of Bassae, we may be well aware that the sculptures were originally part of a religious sanctuary, not a museum. But religion in what sense? How are we to think of the religion practiced in a Greek temple? And were religious objects not also works of art for the Greeks, as well as for us? This temple, as we shall discover, was in the middle of nowhere, the back of beyond, on the side of a mountain. What was the point of a temple there? Did no one ever come to visit it as a tourist rather than a pious pilgrim to see the sights? Did no ancient visitor want some of the scenes, barely visible 7 meters up, explained? How different was a visit of theirs from our visit to the museum? How sure can we be, in other words, about the gap that separates us and them, about what we share with the 5th century BCE visitors to this temple? Pilgrims, tourists, worshippers? And what sets us apart? There are questions, too, about the histories that unfold within that gap. These sculptures are not simply objects of a story shared only by us and those who first built and used the temple. What did Bassae mean to the inhabitants of Roman Greece when, 300 or so years after our temple was constructed, the great superpower of ancient Rome had added Greece to the biggest empire the world had ever known? Did Roman conquest make a difference to who came to this temple and to the expectations they had? And what of the intrepid group of explorers who braved the bandits of then Turkish Greece to rediscover the temple and bring its sculpture back to England? Was that an enterprise of imperialism, of exploitation, that now embarrasses us? Were they tourists, rather like us, or not? How did Bassae fit into their vision of the classical world? Is that a vision that we can share with them, based, at least in part, on shared admiration for the literature, art, and philosophy of Greece and Rome? Us and them. Classics. Classics is a subject that exists in the gap between us and the world of the Greeks and Romans. The questions raised by classics are the questions raised by our distance from their world, and at the same time, by our closeness to it, and by its familiarity to us. In our museums, in our literature, languages, culture, and ways of thinking. The aim of classics is not only to discover or uncover the ancient world, though that is part of it, as the rediscovery of Bassae or the excavation of the furthest outposts of the Roman Empire on the Scottish borders shows. Its aim is also to define and debate our relationship to that world. This book will explore that relationship and its history, starting from a spectacle that is familiar, but at the same time, as we shall see, can become puzzling and strange, dismembered fragments of an ancient Greek temple put on show in the heart of modern London. In Latin, the word museum once indicated a temple of the muses. In what respects is the modern museum the right place to preserve treasures from a classical temple? Does it only look the part? The issues raised by Bassae provide a model for understanding classics in its widest sense. Of course, classics is about more than the physical remains, the architecture, sculpture, pottery, and painting of ancient Greece and Rome. It is also, to select just a few things, about the poetry, drama, philosophy, science, and history written in the ancient world and still read and debated as part of our culture. But here, too, essentially similar issues are at stake. Questions about how we are to read literature which has a history of more than 2,000 years written in a society very distant and different from our own. To read Plato's writings on philosophical topics, for example, involves facing that difference and trying to understand a society, 4th century BCE Greece, in which writing came not in printed books, but on papyrus rolls, each one copied by the hand of a slave, and in which philosophy was still thought of as an activity that went on in the open-air life of the city and was part of a social world of drinking and dinner. Even when philosophy became a subject for study in lecture and classroom, in its own right, as it had become to some extent by the 4th century, it remained a very different business from our own academic tradition. For all that Plato's school was the original academy, named after a suburb of Athens. On the other hand, remote or not, to read Plato is also to read philosophy that belongs to us, not just to them. Plato is still the most commonly read philosopher in the world, and as we read him now, we inevitably read him as part of our philosophical tradition. In the light of all those philosophers who have come since, who themselves had read Plato, this complex, interactive process of reading, understanding, and debate is itself the challenge of classics. The Temple of Bassae is unique, unrepeatable, and the range of questions it raises is not quite like that raised by any other monument or text. This audiobook will follow all kinds of different trails set by the temple, its sculptures, and its history, from the mythical conflicts represented on its walls, men fighting women, men fighting monsters, and the particular puzzles of its purpose, function, and use, to the slave labor that built the temple, the landscape that surrounds it, the ancient visitors who admired it, and not least, the succeeding generations who have rediscovered and reinterpreted it. Every survival from the classical world is, of course, unique. At the same time, as this audiobook will show, there are problems, stories, questions, significances that all those survivals hold in common. There is a place in our cultural story that they, and only they, share. That, and reflection on that, amounts to classics. Chapter 2. On Sight. All the way to Greece. The story of the rediscovery of the temple at Bassae is one of exploration, good luck, friendship, coincidence, international diplomacy, pressure salesmanship, and murder. It is also a story that reveals a lot about the different ways classics might even now be defined and understood. The story starts in Athens, in the early years of the 19th century. Not the sprawling modern capital, but a messy little town under Turkish rule. About 1,300 houses, not much more than a village. Certainly not a tourist center. There was nowhere handy to stay, only a monastery or an obliging widow if you were lucky. And there was no one to help you out, except other foreign visitors and a few long-term foreign residents. In other words, you'd do well to go native and keep in step with Lord Byron, the most famous English visitor of the time. Or, better still, you could court Louis-Sébastien Fauvel, who lived most of his life in Athens, where he held a fistful of now misleadingly grand titles, French consul for one. Fauvel knew everybody and could wrangle more or less anything for you, even a pass up to the great temple of the Parthenon, which then housed a mosque in the middle of the Turkish governor's fortress, long demolished to clear the temple for Greece, whether pagan or Christian, for Greece. It was here in 1811 that the band of explorers got together. A couple of German painters come architects, and two Danish archaeologists, who had all met as students in Rome. Now joined by two English architects, C.R. Cockerell and John Foster, recently arrived from England via Constantinople, the modern Istanbul. Their first joint expedition was to the ruins of a temple on the island of Aegina, not far from Athens. They embarked on this just as Lord Elgin's final shipments of Parthenon sculpture were being sent back to England. A nice anecdote of coincidence has them put out to sea in a small boat, passing Elgin's great ship, which also had Byron on board, returning home, serenading Byron with one of his favorite songs and being invited on board for a farewell drink or two. It was an auspicious start to a successful expedition. The temple sculptures that they dug out of the ruins ended up, with pride of place, in Prince Ludwig I's of Bavaria's new museum in his capital of Munich, where they are still on show in the Glyptothek. Their next plan was to travel to Bassae, much further away and much more dangerous. The area round about was plagued with malaria, and the first traveler from Western Europe to come across the temple, the Frenchman Joachim Boucher in 1765, had barely lived to tell the tale. When he had tried to make a return visit shortly afterwards, he was murdered by, in Cockerell's words, the lawless bandits of Arcadia. Nevertheless, the group believed, from an ancient description of the temple written by a Greek traveler of the 2nd century CE, that it had been designed by the same architect as had designed the Parthenon, the acknowledged masterpiece of ancient architecture. The possibility of finding another Parthenon was in their sights, and they left Athens to arrive at Bassae late in 1811. It was Cockerell who first discovered the frieze. After a few days camped out on the hillside and poking around in the ruins, he noticed a fox coming out of its deep lair under a load of the temple debris. When he investigated, he found that amongst this debris, down in the lair, was a carved marble slab, which he rightly recognized as a piece of the temple's frieze. The team carefully covered it back up again and went away to strike a deal with the Turkish authorities, permitting them to find and remove the rest. They came back the next year without Cockerell, who had moved on to Sicily, and one of the Danes, who had died of malaria. Raising an army of local workmen and braving attacks from bandits, most likely neighbors, if not cousins, of their workers, they dug up the frieze and other smaller pieces of sculpture and carried them the 30-odd kilometers down to the sea and off to the nearby island of Zante, which was then, conveniently, occupied by the British Navy. It only remained to sell them off. One way of telling this story might be as a tale of aristocratic culture and privilege. Classics as the grand tour, the pastime of English nobility and their European equivalents, just the names of the Germans give it away, Baron Halle von Hallestein, Baron Otto Magnus von Stackelberg. Upper-class boys who had learned Latin and Greek at school followed that up with a cultural trip to Greece itself, with plenty of rowdy drinking and scrapes over the local girls thrown in, no doubt. This was the world of an elite, rich enough to travel and, if you think about the proceeds of the sale of the treasures, enriched by it too, and fast. But it is more complicated than that. Think for a moment about what they were discovering Greece for. Some of the Bassae party had far more practical aims than our image of the grand tour would suggest. Cockerell himself was certainly well-heeled, but his tour had, at least in part, a professional agenda. He was an architect, looking for masterpieces of ancient building from which to learn his craft. In particular, he was curious to see how far the surviving remains of Greek temples matched up with the recommendations of Vitruvius, an ancient Roman architect whose architectural handbook was still in use as a professional manual. This was not just the disinterested pursuit of beauty and culture. The ancient world was offering a practical model of design, of how to do it for the contemporary craftsman. In much the same way, young artists of the period learned their skills from a study of ancient sculpture, from endless copying and recopying of plaster casts of ancient statues, or, better still, of the originals themselves. This was not as part of a course in the history of art, but as a practical lesson from the best sculpture, it was believed, the world had ever produced. Today, artistic training no longer relies on Greece and Rome as its main means of instruction. In fact, earlier this century, plaster casts of ancient sculpture were thrown out in their hundreds by British art schools, smashed in an exaggerated effort to assert freedom from what was seen, wrongly or rightly, as the cramping constraints of such classical teaching. But the role of the classical world as a practical model, whether for design or for behavior, still forms part of our own debates. Many of our recent architectural controversies, for example, have focused on the question of whether classical architectural forms are still the best and most appropriate to imitate. Think also about the motley international group that made up the expedition to Bassae. Germans, Danes, English, with the invaluable help of a Frenchman. Then remember that at the time of their discoveries, Europe was in the middle of the Napoleonic Wars. This was not just a group of like-minded aristocrats. It was a group of potential enemies. Classics and the rediscovery of the classical world drew them together, not only because here, outside the fray, they could share some academic and cultural interests and never mind the war. Classics could represent a much more fundamental challenge to the nationalist interests of 19th century Europe. The rediscovery of Greece was, in a way, the rediscovery of the origins of Western culture as a whole. It offered a way of seeing the origin of all European civilization that transcended local, nationalist squabbles. Never mind that those squabbles were always ready to rise to the surface again when it came to auctioning off the classical treasures that had been discovered. The point was that Greece gave Western culture common roots that all educated people, at least, could share. As we shall see in Chapter 8, it is in much the same spirit that, almost 200 years later, ancient Athens can still be seen as the ultimate ancestor of democracy worldwide, a unifying origin of a favored political system. even if we disagree about quite what democracy really means, what it has ever meant, or whose version is best. Even disputes and wars could seem, on all sides, to replay ancient battles, literally going over the same old ground. To those who received a classical education across modern borders, events could have the feel of familiar quotations. But the single most important fact about the expedition to Bassae is that it was an expedition. For centuries, classics has involved not just sitting in a library reading the literature that survives from the ancient world or visiting museums to see neatly displayed sculpture. It has involved journeys of discovery to find classics and the classical world on the ground, wherever they are preserved.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.